Pussies.
What's poppin', internet? Welcome to another episode of the Synced Up Filmcast, a show where we reel you into movie news and talk about the things that we've been watching. I'm one of your hosts, Timothy DeRoe, and joining me this week is your boy, Michael Clear. How you doing on this fine late Monday post-Fast 9?
Definitely in the evening.
Yep. Mm-hmm. How you feeling?
I'm feeling good.
You on your shit today?
You know, I've taken some time recently to reflect on what matters to me most in life.
Yeah, you want
to
be an agent of change?
No.
Oh.
Family.
Family? Yeah.
We'll talk about that later.
Yeah, you could do anything with family, frankly. Who needs the fucking Avengers when you got family?
Exactly, that's what I'm saying.
Today we're going to talk about where we rank Bambi and Dumbo.
Bambi and Dumbo.
Dumbo and Bambi in our Disney Animation Studios proper films ranking top 50, which is going to be 51 once Encanto comes out.
Encanto.
We're also going to talk about some money numbers for Black Widow and a couple other things, some trailers and whatnot. A lot of stuff going on. But before we get into that, Do you enjoy our show? If you do, you should consider supporting us on Patreon at patreon.com/syncedup, where for $1 you can get access to our lovely Discord, where we talk about Dumbo and Bambi and many other things. We do trivia and Bambi trivia. And for $5, you get access to post shows of both of our shows and many more goodies, all from youtube.com/syncedup podcast and podcasting services around the globe. Ooh, new episodes of this show go up in both of those feeds Tuesdays, 7 a.m. Central Time Zone. Gang, you can also write into the show to syncedupod@gmail.com or the reader submissions tab in that lovely Discord that we talked about that you can get for $1. And we might read those comments, questions, concerns, games, anything on the show that you write in
That's
those
true.
Places. Also, you should follow us on Twitter at SyncedUpPod. I almost said it, gmail.com again. Just at SyncedUpPod to keep up to date with all of our content from across the board. Now it's time to get into the show. Let's start off with the Disney rankings. Boom, 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 boom.
Quick refresher, number one right now is Pinocchio, and in dead last, Snow White.
It's Snow White. So we are going to be ranking Dumbo and Bambi. Let's start her off with Dumbo. Here's a 1941 review for you from the Times for Dumbo. Dumbo, a film you will never forget. Maybe you can I do it in the old? Maybe you think you were barking. No, I don't think I can do it. Maybe you think we were barking a little bit louder than we should, but this is a sober opinion. Believe us, which takes into account the pristine freshness of Snow White, the sparkling beauty of Pinocchio, and the rich, enchanting variety of the more recent Fantasia. This time they have let their kindlier natures... I wouldn't say that. Have more commanding play. There's a truly brilliant sequence, one of the finest things that Disney has yet done, in which phantasmagoria.
It's a big word.
Yo, Google that for me, Jordan. Phantasmagoria. PH.
A ghostly. What's magoria?
Phantasmagoria. Phantasmagoria. Bring up that definition
ghostly
for me.
Ghostly fantasy?
First things first. There's a video game by this name.
Phantasmagoria. That's not phasmophobia.
That's phantasmagoria.
That's odd. Bring up the definition so I can see it.
That's a big word.
Phantasmagoria.
Phantas. Okay, cool.
They like to use their big words back in the
day. Guess what you think it is.
I don't fucking know.
I bet you you're right.
A ghostly experience. I don't know.
A group of ghosts.
You got to get off the phantom part, bro.
I can't.
I don't know.
Fantastic.
It's a sequence of real or imaginary images like those seen in a dream.
Oh.
Damn. Okay.
Wow. They got big words.
All right. Thank you for that. Phantasmagoria of pink elephants glide and mold through the grotesque patterns and shapes after Dumbo has sipped the champagne. There is also that hilarious business in which the elephants build themselves into a pyramid, groaning and wobbling atop one another in ponderous and perilous suspense. There's Jim Crow, the loud and fancy sport who cackles. Well, we got an interesting conversation to be had about Jim Crow. We're not just going to gloss over that, I assure you. You just got to get through this review. Well, Hush Mabeek and his raffish crew of dusky satellites, the messenger stork who sings a jingle when he delivers Dumbo to Mrs. J and Casey Jones Jr., the circus engine which squeals and jumps forward whenever the rattling cars bump into him. Very wisely, Mr. Disney has held the picture to an hour of running time, which is an excellent concession to young children, and he has not let any horror stuff slip in.
So
that's interesting.
Is that a callback to Fantasia?
Well, yeah, I guess you would assume
that's what I'm assuming. Yeah.
That would be good news to many. But one problem is definitely posed. In the opening sequence of the picture, an army of storks are delivering babies to the circus animals. Modern parents are going to find that tough phenomenon to explain. Need we further mention that the color is excellent, that the musical score is good, and that the story is neatly constructed, and that the animation is perfect? Or shall we just say, go see Dumbo, and guarantee you will agree with Jim Crow that you've been done seen about everything when you've seen an elephant fly. Now, before we get into our thoughts on Dumbo and some of the more racial tones that we need to discuss, let's talk about Fielding and Chance's opinions on Dumbo. Fielding wrote in, "I'm sure I got some enjoyment watching this movie as a kid, but I didn't like watching it at all as an adult. The animation bothered me for some inexplicable reason. The whole vibe of the movie doesn't sit well with me." Chance writes in, apparently my childhood was a lie because I thought he flew the entire movie, but it doesn't even happen until the last 5 minutes. I thought this movie was as forgettable as Snow White, but I will shout out the Pink Elephant Parade, which was a nice trip. So I agree with most of these points personally. I'm going to go through here. Let's talk about the
I got my notes.
Oh, you got your notes?
This is the most I've written on one movie.
Yeah. So let's go through the plot here first because, of course, I run through the plot going through and then we'll talk about our own personal notes. So
interesting before the movie started, though, that they showed a little...
A disclaimer.
Yeah, they said warning about there are some harmful stereotypes that are present in this movie. But they felt like it'd be even weirder to just try and take
delete them out. And I personally think you could delete them and the movie still be the same. But I appreciate the fact that they put that disclaimer there. So we started off with the storks delivering the babies. It was a little weird. But, you know, I liked the little map thing that they had going on there. The little zoom out map.
Yeah,
thing.
I thought that was really cool, too. It's very like.
Yeah.
Because the previous two movies have been pretty fantastical.
Mm-hmm.
And this one was first like. Cemented in like kind of our world.
Yeah
America,
then we're riding the train Jumbo, Mrs. Jumbo doesn't have a baby, then we get a baby, then we transition into the Roustabout song, which is the racism in question.
Well, before you get there though, you get introduced to the other elephants.
Mm-hmm. Bitches. Yeah,
so
bitches.
Mean.
Oh yeah,
so absolutely mean. Oh yeah, for no reason.
So fucking rude. Yeah. Over the top.
Getting
rude
on to my man's about his big ears.
Yeah. Oh, we got big ears. He's not a an elephant, a true elephant. Yeah, exactly. Then you get into the Roustabout song, which is quite problematic, which I will discuss at the end of this recap here. Mm-hmm. Then we're at the circus. Dumbo getting made fun of for having his ears, and his mom gets locked up. And
she goes hard there.
She goes ham. She goes ham to start destroying stuff. Mm-hmm. Then she gets locked up. Then this is when the ladies really talk shit about Dumbo and talk about how we pledge that he's no longer an elephant.
Was that after the tumble in the circus?
Yeah.
He takes their whole circus down.
Wait, No. Not yet.
They do that after.
Yeah. Well, they talk shit about him. Like,
They're like talking rumors about mom.
Yeah. And then And then, the mouse shows up, comes in clutch. He pulls an inception mode on the owner of the thing to get Dumbo into the thing.
Yeah.
By, like, you know, going into his ear and incepting into
Dumbo,
his dreams.
Dumbo.
Yeah. Then this is when you get the elephant pyramid. Of course, you stack the elephant pyramid, and then everything gets fucked because Dumbo trips on his ears.
Yeah. It takes down the whole circus, almost murdering hundreds of people.
Of course. Then circus gets fucked. Then you get the clown scene where the clowns are just splashing water on his face.
Here I put... I hate clowns, not like a fear or phobia. They just kind of suck.
Yeah, they do just kind of suck.
I mean, they do nothing for me.
Yeah.
Except just give me like a...
Yeah. Then you get the only real touching scene of the entire movie where he interacts with his mother and where she's locked up.
Child of Mine.
And she sticks the trunk out and then touches it.
The song at that moment is Child of Mine, I think, or Baby of Mine. Song. It's really cute.
Yeah, it's a cute song.
You get the whole scene of all the animals.
Then we drink some of that alcohol, and then we get Pink Elephant Parade.
Okay, so I put... Disney probably said we can save money on animation if we just make all the clowns shadows.
Yeah.
And then all that money went straight into the
Pink Elephant scene. The Pink Elephant scene is really, really long and very extravagant.
It's
I like that scene a lot. Then after that scene, you get introduced to the crows and Mr. Jim Crow, another problematic thing of the era, which we will talk about in a bit. Then your boy learns to fly, and then you get the end.
And that
of
was
movie.
Like in the last five, yeah, six
then
movies.
You know, they redo the thing with the clowns, but then he flies and everybody loves him, and boom, movie ends.
And then all of a sudden Dumbo's a millionaire.
Yep,
and
he's a millionaire.
Mouse is making money.
Mom's
too.
Sitting good, and that's about it. So, I got a couple of notes here. An open acknowledgement of harmfully depicting cultures and people I thought was appreciated and interesting in the modern era. They didn't implement that until October of 2019, but that was the thing that they put in there. Mm-hmm. I like that. I don't know if it's just me, but off the jump, it felt so different from the previous two films.
Yeah. And yeah. So what I put is something about the colors. Let's see. I said it uses a different color palette than Pinocchio did.
Yeah.
And it's way more like brighter colors. Yeah. Like.
And then the humans themselves are very backgroundish, except for the main guy.
And then... everything kind of looked like building blocks almost. You know, like when you get those yellow, green, red building blocks?
Yeah, I know
blocks?
What you're talking about.
That's what the trains kind of look like. That's the vibe I got a lot.
Mm-hmm. Very hard edges.
The color.
The map thing was weird, but I enjoyed it.
I thought it was cool.
Of course, I put the note just racist. I wrote that as soon as that song came on, and I was like, man. Yeah. And then I said, I think we're back to not having too much of a plot, personally. I don't think there's much. I think this is not better than Snow White, but not as good as Pinocchio in the plot area. The movie was very short, just an hour and 4 minutes.
Well, wasn't Pinocchio? Pinocchio was like hour 20.
Maybe? Yeah.
None of them have been over an hour 30.
Yeah. Then I put that there's the weirdest LSD trip scene, which was weird.
Pretty cool, though.
Yeah. Then anybody who had epilepsy at the time, totally just getting gassed.
Oh, yeah, at the end of the pink elephant scene.
Yeah.
So I kind of talked to my dad about this movie, and he said that that the pink elephant scene, when he was younger, he was speaking either on himself or my mom, that it was like, that's the scene that stuck with them.
Yeah.
And so they, like, going back and watch that movie, they don't want to because it's kind of like, I don't know, just something about it didn't feel right as a kid.
Yeah.
So probably going back and watching it.
Be weird.
Doesn't seem right either.
Yeah.
So, and I can see that. It was definitely nightmare fuel material.
Yeah, of course.
But it was cool.
Yeah. I agree. The pink elephant scene is pretty stellar. I like some of the interactions with the mom. I thought the mouse wasn't as good of a character as they were, like, in terms of, like, moralistically?
Yeah.
Morally, as they were making them out to be. I did write down a note that elephants don't drink in the way that they had them depicted in the thing where he just sucks it up his nose. That's not how they do it in real life. But, hey, I'm a stickler.
Square bubbles.
Yeah.
I don't think you can do that in real life.
Yeah, blowing all that stuff. That was weird. Of course, elephants don't fly. It's an animation movie, so that's just being nitpicky. But I think, it's impossible to ignore the blatant racism in this movie. And I had the interesting conversation with my father about that whole ordeal,
mm-hmm.
Which ended up being an interesting conversation. Didn't really go sour as I expected it to. But I think my dad's opinion is still just kind of rough in that area, in which that, like, I was like, Disney was like a notorious racist and stuff, and then my dad was like, oh, not really, I mean, when you think about the times, and I was like, I mean, that's still racism. Yeah. it's just more accepted.
You can acknowledge it for what it is during that time, mm-hmm. without condemning, like,
and so yeah product. And so I think there's an interesting conversation to be had of, do we knock the movie for these racist depictions in our modern ranking of these Disney movies, or do we look at them and just acknowledge those scenes as for the times and try to rank the movies disregarding said racism?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know.
I think I prefer the latter.
Yeah.
Because while the roundabout song was uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And the Jim Crow thing was weird. Specifically just cause it's a white guy, mm-hmm. talking jive. I still think it was a good movie.
Yeah.
And so I think it's important to, you can rank it how you want to, disregarding it, but you cannot refuse to acknowledge those things.
Yeah.
So when I rank it, I'm acknowledging that, yes, these things are present.
Mm-hmm.
They're not appropriate for modern times.
Yeah.
But the movie holds up in other regards.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't know. It's a tough discussion to have on that.
So if you could bring up the ranking, Jordan, on the Google Doc here. Of course, zoom in a little bit. We got Pinocchio and we got Snow White, number one and number one Pinocchio, number two Snow White. Where do you personally rank Dumbo in the listing?
Number two. I think you're bumping Snow White down.
Yeah, I personally I think I would agree with that. At first I thought that Dumbo was a little, you could just go before it and click enter so you don't have to type it all again. But like, I personally thought at first that Snow White was better than Dumbo, but upon thinking about it more, I think Snow White is still, mm-hmm. and it's their first foray into film. So there you go, Pinocchio, Dumbo, and Snow White. Now let's get into Bambi. Let's start off with, again, from the Times, 1942 Bambi review here. After 5 long years of labor, Walt Disney's wizards have caught much of the breathless and breathtaking fantasy of Felix Salten's tremulous story of the little fawn who grew up in the woodland with his assorted playmates and finally became a great forest prince like his father. In colors, such spoilers in these fucking early reviews, man.
Mm-hmm.
In colors that would surprise even the spectrum itself, Disney's cartoon craftsmen have recreated a woodland that shimmers and glows and darkens altogether magically. The wind over a green field, the morning light in the meadow, the hushed naves of the forest inhabited by all sorts of hidden folk, the artists have made a simple and loving a touch. It would be churlish to rebuke an effort that has caught so much startling beauty or that so often touches the heart with the humor that is both inventive and wise. And yet, for all its frequent gossamer loveliness, Bambi left at least one grown-up more than a little disappointed. Ooh. For in recreating Salten's fable, Mr. Disney has again revealed a discouraging tendency to trespass beyond the bounds of cartoon fantasy into the tight naturalism of magazine illustration. His painted forest is hardy, is hardly to be distinguished from real forest from the real forest shown by the Technicolor camera in Jungle Book, because Bambi and his mother are naturalistically conceived. The fact that they speak like people becomes wildly incongruous because the stags are similarly drawn. Their stiff leaps across the meadow merely throw into relief the failure of pen and brush to catch the fluent movement of real photography. A waterfall that does not ripple with complete realism tears apart the illusion of a naturalistically contrived forest. No doubt these considerations, man, they talked so different back then. Mm. No doubt these considerations will seem academic to the children at the music hall, for Bambi is their picture and childhood sometimes has a literal mind. No doubt they even will forgive Mr. Disney for putting false eyelashes on his enticing female bunnies. In his search for perfection, Mr. Disney has come perilously close to tossing away his whole world of cartoon fantasy. Meanwhile, of course, Bambi is going to please a great many people, for all our churlish exceptions. So it seems this person really had a problem with, I don't know, the fact that it wasn't realism? I don't know.
Well, I think it was that they were trying to do both.
Yeah.
Like at some moments, Bambi's very realistic and then Thumper's not.
Yeah.
You know, stuff like that. So I think that's kind of what they're going for.
Let's get into Chance's and Fielding's thoughts here. Fielding writes in for Bambi. The voice changes for Thumper and Bambi are hilarious to me. They make me laugh every time I hear them. Fun fact, I read the book in middle school and was surprised at how graphic it was. Thumper's mom dies and Bambi gets shot. Definitely less upbeat than the movie. The book was also banned in Nazi Germany for being a political allegory on the treatment of Jews in Europe. The author was Jewish and he was actually an avid hunter as well. It seems he drew quite a bit from personal experience while writing the book and gives me a different perspective when watching the Disney movie. Fielding always coming in with the facts.
He does some research here.
Of course. I'd love to see it, Fielding. Very much appreciate these facts. Then Chance writes in, this movie will always hold a special place in my heart. It was one of the first movies I ever remember watching, and as a kid, my family used to call me Thumper for reasons. Bambi and Thumper's friendship is so wholesome to watch, and Bambi's mother's death is heart-wrenching every single time. This is Disney's best animation so far. They really showed out animating all those adorable animals. Now, of course, we're going to run you through the plot before we get into our own personal thoughts and then rank this beautiful movie. So you start off in the forest, waking up everyone, you know, hey, let's go to the glaive. Let's see what's going on. What are you looking at?
The mics.
Oh, we're not on the, he scrolled. Oh, okay. You're good to go. Panic had ensued. Then of course the prince is born. The new prince is born. And then you get a little bit more, the whole, oh, he's a little stumbly, isn't he? And then this, for some reason, I remember this scene so vividly. The, if you can't say something nice, don't say anything at all.
See, I remember it too, but I feel like I was very much struggling. Like, does this seem familiar just because I'm familiar with the phrase?
Yeah.
Or because I've seen this part of the movie.
I remember that part of the movie vividly for some reason. Hmm. Then you get Bambi learning to talk. Bird.
Dude, that's one of my notes. I just put bird in all caps.
Yeah. Bird. And then flower. Yeah, and then you get the introduction to the skunk, who then becomes called Flower at that point. Then you get Drip Drop Little April Shower.
Drip, drip, drop, little April shower. Yo, I actually had some.
The rain scene.
I feel like there was a thing in music and just scores in general back then that, like, when you're writing the score for a movie or, like, just large musical pieces back then, you have to have, like, this scary moment where the music just goes into, like, a minor key and then, like, thunder and lightning. And, like, you just had to have that.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. That was something interesting to me. That's where my mind went.
Yeah. Yeah. I have some notes down here at the end. Once I'll get to those. I'm talking about that same kind of little thing. Then you get the meadow where she's like, oh, be careful. The meadow. And then they go out there and then everyone's vibing in the meadow. And then Feline shows up. That's where you get the introduction to the other deer in the forest. And then you get to see the great prince guy where you're like, oh, it's the great prince. And then you realize that's Bambi's father. You get somebody starts blasting. Everyone's running.
Yep.
Then you get a little bit of a time skip to winter when we discover snow. Mm-hmm. We're like, whoa, mom, what's all the white stuff on the ground? And she's like, oh, it's snow. And then he's like stumbling and falling. And that's cool. And then the spring grass, you get another time skip. And then that's when mom gets clipped. Yep. Still fucked me up. Even though I knew it was coming, I was still like, damn, man, this shit.
40 minutes into the movie, though.
Yeah.
Real late.
Again, I think this harkens back to the thing that Chance was talking about, where I think a theme with these Disney movies is that and you said it too, that you're realizing that some of the major things that you thought were like the whole point of the movie were like just towards the end very and very minor. Down. Yeah, and it's like, damn, okay. So then you get your mother can't be with you anymore, right? And then you get a massive time skip to spring, to a spring in the future when everyone's older.
Yeah.
Bambi, everybody's Thumper, Flower, everyone has different voices.
Every time they spoke, I was just not prepared for it.
Yeah, yeah. Then you get the Twitter-pated explanation, which is him just talking about love. And then you get everyone falling in love with Flower falling in love with the skunk, Thumper falling in love with the orange bunny, and then Bambi falling in love, of course, with Feline, and she is back. Then you get him jumping through the clouds in the dream, and then that one dude shows up, and he has to fight for the girl.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, oh, shit, what's going on? And then you get the scene where they're fighting. It's a little weird, but they fight for it. And then you get hella gunshots and hunting dogs after that.
Oh, yeah, they started blasting.
Blasting. The hunting dogs are chasing everything. And then I put here, Bambi gets shot in a question mark because it seems like it's insinuated.
Yeah.
But you never see anything of it. And then I said there's a wildfire because he jumps. Right, he's good and he's running, yeah. And then he jumps. Then you hear a gunshot, and then he's down.
Yeah,
but you never
see
him getting shot.
And I think Fielding kind of confirms that for us. Where he, I think he was unsure about it, but the book says he got shot.
So I think he gets shot.
I think he gets clipped.
They just kind of,
And then the big prince is like, get up.
Get up, get up, because there's a wildfire. The wildfire goes hard. And then Bambi and Dad are all running and jumping, and then they got to jump down the waterfall to escape the fire, get down there and swim. And then you get another time skip. Flower has named his kid Bambi. Everyone gathers in the spring for Bambi's kids to be born. And then, you
twins.
Know, love is a song that never ends. You know, heavenly choir, yada, yada, yada.
Yep.
And so I got a few notes here. I don't know why I remember Thumper so well. The character, the voice, the animation,
Thumper
everything.
Thumper is my dude.
Locked
that's
in my
what I
brain.
About him. He, good dude. Before, in the introduction scene, there was very much like 3D artwork at play that they hadn't done before. So I thought that was interesting.
Yeah. I put that the rain song was pretty good with the vocals simulating the wind and the cymbals simulating the lightning. I thought that was very interesting. And then I said, being four movies deep now, it's very apparent how important of a role music played in these earlier films, not just the singing portions, but the orchestration. And that's what I was talking about with
the
wind, like everything, even in like the little dances and the little scary parts. And though you watch something like Moana, you get 15 minutes of talking and then you jump into a song. Whereas in these earlier films, every little action that they do, a run, a prance, a jump, is accented by some sort of orchestration in the film. And then I also said, this dude has an absent father. Like, bruh.
Oh, yeah. It was at this point I put, didn't know Bambi would meet another deer when he finally meets with Feline.
Yeah.
I don't remember any of that.
Yeah.
I barely remember this movie. I just remember Thumper.
Yeah.
And I did not remember him meeting another deer. I didn't remember him having his own kids or any of that. So I'm honestly not sure I've seen that movie.
And then I put, it's weird that the easiest way to differentiate gender in animals is through a slight change in coloration. Even before you hear their voice, it kind of automatically clicks in your head that, oh, that skunk is the female skunk because she's a slightly lighter hue. Oh, that one is a female bunny because it's peach and orange. And like, it was weird. I just thought that was an interesting thing that like your brain so easily is like, oh, yeah, that's the different just because a slight change in coloration. And so that is it for my notes. Any other thoughts on Bambi before we rank this bad boy?
We halfway through and we still got an alive mother. I'm worried. snow scene is cute. Bambi grown up. I hated the voice changes, honestly. They just made me feel
too. Luckily, it's towards the very end. So
I put, is really a massacre going on? Because you have that bird that's like, we got to move.
Yeah.
We got to move. And they're like, don't move.
Yeah.
She's like, I'm going. She goes, gets clipped.
Causes the whole thing. She's
it
like, I can't take it anymore.
It's crazy.
And then people are getting everyone tries to run into a hole, and then the hole gets blasted.
I said, and then I ended with kind of some Lion King vibes. Circle of life for sure.
It's man has returned. Returned to the forest.
Those are the notes I have.
Those are the notes I have. Jordan, bring up the ranking. We're gonna rank the fourth movie.
We're finally gonna have some difference of opinion here.
Okay, where do you rank Bambi in the grand scheme of ranking? One through four.
I could comfortably put it at three. I could even put it at four.
Okay.
I did not enjoy this movie that much. I thought it was okay. So I could easily put it below Snow White. But I think you're gonna have a higher, so I think three is probably gonna be
You're locking it in at three. Under Dumbo, above Snow White?
No, I want to put it at four. I'm preemptively putting it at three because I think you're going to put it at two.
Okay, well, I'm going to put it at one.
What?
I think it's better than Pinocchio.
Wow.
I personally think it's better than Pinocchio.
And I think it's worse than Snow White.
Yes, which I think if you locked it at three and I locked it at one, that puts it at two.
So if I had locked in at four, though, where does that put it?
Then at that point, I don't know what the fuck happens. If you, then I think we just consult what everyone else's rankings were in the Discord. Yeah.
Okay. Well, Fielding has.
Because Fielding's high on it, and then in terms of the Discord, if I check, I believe
Spencer also posted his.
Spencer put it at one, and yeah. Chance put it at two.
I'll let you put it at two.
Okay,
I think that's fair.
From the community, and then from
where you put it, and I put it. I actually enjoyed Dumbo more than Bambi.
Yeah,
and I enjoyed Pinocchio more than Bambi too.
Yeah, I could say I enjoyed Pinocchio a lot, but I don't know, man. It just didn't do it for me as much as
Bambi
I thought Bambi
didn't
did.
Didn't have anything that like stayed with me.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe
I don't think it will.
Maybe
it was
just
very forgettable.
Yeah, the upgrade and the fact that I shed a tear, the upgrade in animation and stuff, I think just did it for me. Personally, I thought Dumbo was a massive drag. I could not get through it at all.
Really? That's how I felt about Bambi.
I was sleeping. So that's it for the Disney rankings. Let me look up what we have next week. I believe it's Cinderella and Alice in Wonderland. I will double
kind of
check.
For Alice in Wonderland.
I'll double check here. So yeah, next week watch Cinderella and Alice in Wonderland, and then next Monday or Tuesday for you guys, we will be ranking Alice in Wonderland and Cinderella. I'll give you a little tease of what's come after that. The following week, Peter Pan, Lady and the Tramp, and then the week after that, Sleeping Beauty, and then finally 101 Dalmatians.
I'm excited to get through this era here.
Yep. Well, and then
we got some good ones along.
Then we'll start getting into some of the more modern ones after that. And then I think we don't start getting into like the classics till we get into the 20s with Aladdin, Lion King, Pocahontas, Hercules, Mulan, Tarzan, those ones. So
I think the first one's going to be The Little Mermaid. That's like of that classic.
Yeah, that like that echelon. Yeah. So there you have it, folks. The rankings is now as follows. Number one, Pinocchio. Number two, Bambi. Number three, Dumbo. And number four, Snow White. Mm-hmm. Get excited to see where Alice in Wonderland and Cinderella rank next week. Watch those. Write in your thoughts. Join in the Discord. Even if you're not in the Discord and you don't want to pay a dollar, write in your thoughts in the email. We'll read them there as well. And so there you have it. Now let's talk about a little bit of news that happened this week. I personally appreciate the fact that the news has become so ancillary to this show.
Yeah.
Because I think I've become personally fine with the ranking being the major part of this show at this point. Mm-hmm. Even once we finish the Disney, I think if we switch to, like we talked about, the Fast and Furious franchise, maybe we switch to Harry Potter, maybe we do DreamWorks, we do Pixar, maybe we do Disney live action remakes, maybe we do stuff like that.
Yeah.
I have a bunch of ideas of like series that we could personally rank. Pirates of the Caribbean,
well,
shit like that.
Well, I think it's more fun and it's more involved.
And gets with the community, and also has us rewatching classics and getting nostalgic, which is nice. So I think that's enjoyable. I don't think we'll ever do Marvel though, because we had so recently just rewatched Marvel.
It'd have to be a long time.
It would have to be 6 or 7 years before I rewatch Marvel. But let's talk about a little bit of news. I've stopped doing articles now because of this ranking, and I'm enjoying it. So first and foremost, we got a little tidbit of news that this week that the MCU is done focusing on multi-movie deals with actors and actresses.
That's true.
And starting to focus more on single movie deals. There was an interesting conversation that was had in the Discord about this specific change. Personally, I don't like it. But also, I can understand why you don't.
Explain why you don't like it.
The reason I don't like it is because, now, I understand the artistic side of things. You don't want actors and actresses to be locked into years and years and years of having to play the same thing. Mm-hmm. And then you get situations of them starting to hate their life. And I think maybe you should think about that before you sign the dotted line. But hey, that's just me. But in terms of this, the reason I don't like that is because I don't think you get Infinity War and Endgame without these big, massive multi-movie deals. If you don't have multi-movie deals for Robert Downey Jr., Chris Evans, Scarlett Johansson, Chris Hemsworth, all the OGs, and you start them from day one, and then 10 years later, they're in this culmination. You don't get these culmination films without these multi-movie deals. You just do not get them. It doesn't happen. And then, you know, there was a conversation I had with Spencer where he's like, oh, you could just switch the actor or switch the actress. I think that, again, takes away from it. You've seen even the switch to Don Cheadle was like a shock, kind of, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like all of that kind of stuff, I don't think it hits as hard. It's not as cohesive.
Even like Mark Ruffalo, people still.
That was still the shakeup.
Yeah. Still talk about.
And that one's minor. But if you tell me, you know,
Spider-Man's even crazier.
Yeah. If you tell me something like that, like it's just not going to be as good. And Spencer had some interesting topics of, you know, maybe you do alternate universe people, stuff like that. Again, I still think that takes away from the cohesiveness and like the enjoyment of the story. Mm-hmm. Personally, for me, you know, being able to do that over and over again in the comics is a problem in the comics for me. So
I agree with like both of you on this one. The more interesting thing I took from this is that the reason they're doing that is because they're moving away from these multi-movie kind of film things.
Which makes me sad.
That makes me sad.
Me sad.
There, I see a future where we just explore just random Marvel stories.
Yeah.
With whatever characters at
sucks,
this point.
Sucks, man.
And it's maybe, just whoever they can get on.
Yeah, I don't know. I haven't been proven wrong yet. It's my personal prediction that the culmination things that we get are going to be on Disney Plus.
I still think you're wrong. I think you could pay $30 to watch it on Disney Plus.
Not that it comes out. I mean that a Disney Plus show is going to be the next. Is the culmination of it. We're no longer going to get Avengers movies. We might get an Avengers show. The reason I say that is because when you look
Does
at the
culmination
slate,
stuff work in a show.
The reason I say that is because when you look at the future for what's coming in Marvel, the only title or anything of any idea that we have that we know has to be a culmination event besides the Spider-Man movie, just because of the teasers, is not really like too much of a culmination, but it's still a culmination. Is Secret Invasion, which
but that's
is
not
a Disney
be,
show.
It's not going to be the culmination event you want. I think you want comic book Secret Invasion. You're not getting that.
But I think...
You're getting like a normal story.
But even a normal story in Secret Invasion, like the Secret Invasion doesn't work without a bunch of people. Just doesn't work. So either Secret Invasion is a flop, or
which is what I think is going to happen.
I don't think... Hey, there's no way. With the end credit scenes and the way that
so
they're...
so many people in...
I don't think so. And another reason I don't think so is because of these numbers that we're about to talk about coming up with Black Widow for the fucking money that it made. So Black Widow got over $215 million worldwide opening weekend, which is fucking nice.
Yeah.
It's not as much as normal Marvel movies were hitting there towards the end, but I think this is a sign that we're getting back into the groove.
Yeah.
But it is worth noting, $80 million of that was domestic, so U.S. theaters. $78 million of that was international theaters.
Worldwide.
And $60 million of that was just the $30 premiere access on Disney Plus. $60 million.
That's a lot.
I think this has solidified for me the fact that we are transitioning into a future... A future that is different from what we know with movies.
Where both can live?
And I think that COVID has expounded that fact and sped up that process. Mm-hmm. But now we're in this weird new future where Warner Bros. Doesn't have to only release in theaters. I think this premiere access thing is interesting. I think we start seeing streaming services explore some interesting things. Netflix is making Mr. Gray or something with Chris Evans and the Russo brothers, which is their most expensive Netflix original to date, which is coming out in a couple years. Maybe, you know, Netflix doesn't release in theaters, but maybe Netflix for the first month to 2 months releases a premium price for said film. It's a Russo brothers film. Pay $15, you get access to the Russo brothers film, or you wait a month and a half.
Yeah.
Maybe we see some stuff with HBO Max in the same way. The premiere access, maybe we see some expiration in different price levels. You know, maybe Dune is $20, whereas the next Avengers is $40, and then Black Widow is $30. I think we see some interesting stuff here going forward with this pricing model, because I personally did not expect this much money to come from premiere access purchases. It kind of blows my mind, actually.
Yeah. Just an opening weekend.
Yeah, personally, I think this is crazy. And I think that number is going to go up a lot further than... theater
so
numbers.
Another thing is, I think people are going to watch it in the movie theater and want to watch it again at home.
Which
so you're going to have double dippers.
Because we are considering double dipping here.
Well, my parents have it, so we don't have to. We don't have to, but we thought about it.
Exactly, because that movie was good.
It was really good.
It was really good, and I kind of want to watch it again.
We'll get to that.
Yeah, but these numbers are interesting. They're crazy, and I think that it's a shakeup for the future. We have to see a few more movies come out in this fashion.
Mm-hmm.
Is Shang-Chi premium access? I don't think it is. We'll have to see if it performs as even better in the theater, or maybe it performs just as well in the theater and loses the $60 million. I don't know. We'll have to see what Shang-Chi does and things in the future. But is this exciting? I think so.
Yes and no, because I like the theater experience so much. I don't want to see... streaming completely demolished the theater.
But does Shang-Chi and Eternals come out and they realize it doesn't make as much money and then they retransition back to the double? So you can do either or.
I would prefer the either or.
Me too.
And I want it to
because
always be either or.
With these numbers, I think it can exist in tandem.
Yeah.
In a legit way. $60 million and then $80 million at the theaters, I think it can exist. Now, as many theaters be open? I don't think so.
I don't know. Americans love Black Widow.
Yeah.
More than all the other nations combined.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that tends to be the case with these movies.
I know, but
internationally, they don't make as much as they do domestically.
I want to know what Fast 9's numbers were.
Yeah. I don't know.
I'm going to go look that up.
Anyway, That's it for the news and the rankings. Time to watch a couple of trailers, a few trailers actually. So start her off, Jordan, with Encanto, which is the Disney movie, the new Disney Animation Studios movie, which comes out in October and November, which we will pause for a week to rank that movie specifically, to keep our things from getting into an odd number. So rather than rank, you know, Aladdin and Tarzan that week or whatever it ends up being, we'll rank just Encanto because it'll come out in theaters that week. Or maybe we rank it the week following to give people an extra amount of time to be able to see it.
I think so.
But we'll do something like that when that ends up coming out. Well, because Raya is paired with whatever's before it. Because we're at an even... It's 50 movies evenly right now. We're not at an even number. Yeah, we'll figure it out. But it's also better for clicks to do it when it comes out. So we'll figure something out. But anyway, so let's watch the trailer for Encanto, which I personally was a big fan of.
Encanto. Lin-Manuel Encanto. Did the music for this movie?
He did. I'm into this movie, personally. I mean, it's... Of course. I'm into this movie. I think it looks cool.
Very magical house.
I think they don't show us a lot with this trailer. We don't see the conflict. What's the conflict? Who's the villain?
I mean, we get the idea that homegirl.
She doesn't. We'll see. Yeah. She doesn't have a gift. Yeah, obviously, the plot's going to be she's the one who has to save the day. Yeah. Even she has no gift. Or she's going to learn her gift. I don't know. I just think this premise is really cool.
Yeah.
Also, like, I'm into, like, Moana and Raya, like, these more cultural Disney movies that focus on a specific culture I'm into. And maybe I could say that easily as, like, a white guy, because I know Lucas had some, Lucas was like, man, it's Colombia, and, like, you know, they could have done all these other things. So maybe if I was someone who was in this culture, I would have a lot more problems. Maybe I could point out a bunch of problems with it. And so maybe as a white guy, I can easily say that, because I'm just the generic white guy with a beard on the internet. You know, the classic, you see him everywhere. But personally, I really enjoy these a lot.
Yeah, it's something you don't really know.
Yeah. So Colombian culture, Hawaiian culture, the Raya, which would have been that would have been Chinese, right? But just those other cultural movies, I'm really into. When you get stylistically with the animation, with the music, Encanto, with just everything, I'm into it.
Me too. I like that one.
Yeah. So do I. Get looking forward to Encanto. Comes out in the fall, which I believe in November, but I'm not sure.
It just says a fall.
Yeah. But I could have swore in a press release they put a month on it, but I'm not sure.
They might have. I'm not sure.
Anyway, let's watch this next trailer, which is even more fucking exciting in my personal opinion. Comes out August 11th. It's your boy, What If.
Twitter, not a fan.
Twitter, for some reason, not a fan, but I'm stoked.
Yeah, I think this one looks awesome.
I'm so stoked, bro.
Look at us. They were hating
I'd be out of a job with World Peace. Yeah. This is playing at normal speed, right? Because Noah was logged in. It might be at 1.5 speed.
No, this is normal speed.
Yeah.
I switched to our account.
Okay, cool. I thought this was mad interesting.
Killmonger.
What would happen if Killmonger ended up saving Tony Stark?
Iron Man wouldn't need to be Iron Man.
Yeah. And would he fund Killmonger's government takeovers?
I don't know. Wakanda?
It bumped it.
Reality. Doctor Strange. Somewhere.
Yeah. I don't know. What's going on? Jigadoosh. What if it wasn't the Avengers in the Battle of New York? What if it was the Guardians of the Galaxy, bro? Come on, dog. Are you kidding me?
What if the Star-Lord was T'Challa?
Yeah. What if Star-Lord was T'Challa? This is great.
That was just the Hulk. I don't know.
This is fucking great, dude.
Loki.
With an army of Lokis. Howard the Duck is there, you know? Mm-hmm. Well, let's do this. Come on, man. I'm so into this. I'm, like, ridiculously into this. I cannot.
This is going to be super cool.
I cannot express how into it. I'm into this. This is what I'm super into. Let's go, dude. Captain Carter. Let's go, dude. Ugh. I'm also into, some Spider-Man shit, of course. But what's coming up? This.
Yeah, Zombie Avengers.
The Zombie Apocalypse, man. Let's go.
It looks like there's more than like 8 things going on here.
Yeah, I think we're gonna get a good 16 episode fucking thing, or we're gonna get like a 3 a week, 15 minute episodes.
Maybe. Like a double episode.
I said a Ravager never travels alone. I said never flies solo. Is that some kind of? It's your boy Mary Poppins, y'all.
Yondu OP, dude.
Dude, Yondu is ridiculously overpowered. That arrow is insane. Let's go, dude. I'm stoked for this. Twitter was like, dude, what if looks terrible, man? This animation. Nah, I do not give a damn.
No, and it's gonna. I think it's easily gonna be a series that can carry over more than just like one thing. Like, I don't think we're gonna get WandaVision 2.
No, but
I don't think it's happening. But we might get What If multiple times.
We're getting Loki 2.
What?
Yeah, they confirmed that season 2 for Loki. It's in production right now.
We didn't talk about that in the news.
No, they confirmed this like a long time ago. And Ben had told me, oh, they got a season 2 of Loki. And I was like, nah, they never confirmed that. But then I looked it up. Yeah, no, that was confirmed.
Wow.
Somehow we missed it completely.
Crazy.
Anyway, Witcher season 2 got a teaser trailer. Let's watch that. I haven't actually seen this yet. And this is the last trailer.
I have not seen this one either. I didn't watch the show. Mm-hmm. I'm not involved in this one.
What?
This one's for your boys.
Hello?
What?
What? I don't care about The Witcher.
Oh,
what?
Man, dude.
I've never played the game.
You don't need to play the game, dude. It's Henry Cavill, bro. Come on, man.
Are you going to put the trailer on?
I want to yell at you first.
No, put the trailer on.
I want to get to this pizza, bro. It's all I've been thinking about for the last 6-7 minutes.
Don't think about it too much. It is Little Caesars.
I love Little Caesars, bro. Don't sleep.
So, I'm not. I got it.
So I haven't seen this, so I don't got none of the audio. So Jordan got the best experience, and you listeners
do. That's what's her face. Chicololas.
That's Siri. We haven't seen it either, because I found it when I was talking to Mike, and I was like, we have to watch it on the pod.
Yeah, I seen that they had released the teaser, but I completely forgot about it. I understand some things.
The world is changing.
Toss a coin. I love season one, dude.
I want you guys to know. I know you don't have the audio, but...
Oof. Is it Chris, bro?
Yeah, Chris. Nice. Is
I love season one so much.
Why does it look so much like some Game of Thrones?
Because that's what it is, bro. Cool.
The song in the background is only camera.
Who the hell are you? So is... What's her name? Siri?
Siri.
Was she in season one?
Yeah.
Yes. No. I
feel like I could... Got the steel and the silver blades, baby, bro. Because I don't have any audio, is he teaching her to be a witcher?
Yeah, for the most part.
Let's fucking go, dude.
He's not teaching her yet. He's teaching her the history.
Run. Yeah.
Depending what he is, why he's doing it.
Which means she's going to want to know how... She's going to want to be a witcher.
A second ago, she was talking about how she wants to be...
Cirilla becomes the baddest of them all, dude.
You hide. I really know nothing about this movie.
The Witcher universe is dope as shit. Run!
Vesemir said that the world outside these walls.
Oh, this is a classic.
It's a dangerous place.
I want to see some more signs. Power. Some more usage of the signs in this season.
Where is she?
Yeah.
What if your prince is
smaller than your fucking car? You're gonna get a lot more Witcher stuff.
Yeah, and
like in the first season, it was kind of like hey,
prologue. Yeah,
this definitely has a lot more of all right, Witcher. So we showed you who problem he was. Though, here's what he does, kind of thing.
Problem though is this comes out the same day as Spider-Man. I'm prioritizing Spider-Man.
Gotta throw Yennefer in there, bro.
Yeah, of course. Again,
wouldn't be
December 17th.
That's a nice date. So anyway,
those were it.
That's it for the trailers. Now it's time to talk about the stuff that we've been watching. Of course, we watched Loki, which, of course, is still good.
Big cliffhanger.
I like this episode a lot. Massive cliffhanger.
I thought it was one of the weaker ones.
Yeah.
Simply because I think the plot moves. We did talk about that. The plot definitely moves, but to what? I don't know.
And then there's a lot of cheese.
It's a very cheesy episode.
Yeah. Which we'll be spoiling Loki after next week once the final episode comes out.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be doing that. And then, of course, Dave.
I think this was the best episode.
Yeah, so far I agree. It's great.
Still manages to explore the uncomfortable.
Dude, it's so fucking uncomfortable. Like, the whole time.
This whole one was about like, you know, friends and like growing in different ways and then having their like come reconvene.
Back. Yeah.
And then them fitting back together eventually by the end. And then watching Gata is awesome. And even in real life, like, I don't know if you follow any of the Loki stuff.
Off.
Yeah, his song popped off. He's been getting a lot of support.
Yeah.
People love Gata.
Yeah,
and it's like good to see. Because like, I feel like that's him.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm actually watching like real life Gata. Mm-hmm. Lil Dicky, I'm like, is this real Lil Dicky? But
Gata feels like
Gata. Like this feels like the real guy. So
I agree.
That was cool.
Then I watched iCarly. You missed this week's episode.
Shame.
Which is, shame. It's still hitting. I think I'll give like more cohesive thoughts once the show's all the way over. Then Atypical season 4 dropped a couple days ago.
The whole bitch.
I can't.
And I watched that first episode. Oh, yes, sir. I'd be done with it already if Adrian hadn't.
I thought you finished all.
No, I'd finish the whole thing if Adrian was here. We're gonna watch that shit fast.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of fast. Watch Fast 9.
Fast 9, baby.
Man, what a film! I got a laundry list of issues with that film. Okay, look, dude.
I'm sure you do.
Look, dude.
Family.
It was a fun time.
It was a great time.
It was a fun time.
It was a great time.
But objectively, that movie is garbage.
Nah, family, bro.
That movie is garbage. I can appreciate how blatantly self-aware they are, mm-hmm. right?
Oh, the whole and time. So,
like, dude, okay. All right, hold up.
Yeah, I'm
home. What's coming soon? Space Jam, New Legacy, and Pigs coming out this week. Now it's going to be spoilers for Fast 9 and Black Widow. So if you haven't seen Fast 9, dip out. If you have, stick around, and then we'll also spoil Black Widow. We have no reader mail this week. But, okay, so let's talk about Fast 9.
Yeah.
Okay, I can appreciate how blatant, like, self-aware they are with the fact where, like, what's the dude? What's the, not Ludacris, but the other guy?
Roman.
Roman is like, dude.
We have to just be invincible.
We're invincible, dude. Think about it. Like, we go through all this shit and we don't get hurt. He's like, look at my shirt, bro. There's bullet holes on it. And look at me, dude. I got no scars. And that's like a whole plot line.
Yeah.
So I can appreciate, like, the self-awareness. And they're like, dude, we're in space, dude. Nobody's going to fucking believe this, dude. And then, like, the line where, like, the girl is like, if this were a movie, this is what was going to happen, right? And that's exactly what mm-hmm. happens. So it's, like, blatantly self-aware. But there's also just so much dumb shit. Was it nine Star Wars references in a row?
There was, like, nine Star Wars references in a row.
He's like, dude, get the Millennium Falcon or Chewbacca, call Chewbacca, or get me an X-Wing. And then he goes over to the chick. He's like, dude, I'm Luke Skywalker. It's like, what the fuck is going on?
She dunked his ass.
No, you're Yoda, dude, because Yoda's a puppet with someone's hand up his ass.
Shout out to Charlize Theron.
That movie was great.
That movie was awesome. Like,
Somehow we go to space in a Ford Fiesta.
It's a Pontiac Fiero.
Pontiac Fiero, whatever. Same fucking thing Ford in my Fiesta. Eyes. With a rocket booster strapped to the top of it on an AC-130. And we make it to space. Sense. And we crash into a satellite, don't get hurt, and then manage to drift to the International Space Station.
Now hear me out. Was this the Infinity War of the Fast Universe?
Dude, we got like several films left.
You got everybody in this one.
Yeah.
Because, okay.
Han comes back. Think and he's like, dude, I never died.
You know when Han starts shooting people and you realize it's Han?
Yeah.
That felt like a very Marvel moment.
Yeah, it did.
Oh, my God.
It's Han.
There's Cap standing over there.
But there's just some shit where it's like, they're eating noodles at a random restaurant, and then she's like, looks into a window and is like, dude, it's the Mexican flag. He said Tokyo was his Mexico. That's the building. And it's like, it just so happened to be there at mm-hmm. that building in Tokyo to see the Mexican flag. Like, what the fuck? The thing, the one car is spinning around and he's like running along and then fucking jumps in the driver's seat and then stops that shit at the edge of the mountain and then takes four Tomahawk missiles to the front, doesn't blow up, swings it around, swings the whole truck to blow up the stealth bomber.
It was great. Like, what the fuck? I will say, if we're talking about plot stuff, everything in the past, in like 1989, in that movie, was actually pretty good.
Yeah, it was. I'll agree.
Like,
even though it seemed like Dom completely switched ethnicities.
Yeah.
Because of the character that they had.
But I think that John Cena character was really good.
Yeah,
it looked like him.
Yeah. It's just hard to take John Cena
seriously. All the scenes from back then, the race with his brother.
Yeah.
Like, all that stuff was great.
The race had John Cena looks like the first movies.
Yeah. John Cena looks like a creative character from XCOM, which is weird.
Just in general,
him.
Yeah,
just him.
I agree. Yeah. It's hard to take him serious. The Cardi B
cameo was weird, man.
Unnecessary, but really felt in theme.
On brand.
Very on brand.
Vin Diesel goes full Super Saiyan and rips the ceiling down.
It was pretty badass. I chains. Think this man's been spending a lot of time in the Marvel facilities, been seeing everybody else do badass shit while he just says, I am Groot.
Yeah.
And then he was like, you know what? I'm going to do this in my own movie.
I don't know, man.
I'm going to tear the place down.
I don't even know what's going on. It was pretty badass. So many scenes. I'm
he
like,
picked
dude.
The man up and slammed him on the rail and broke his back.
That so cool. often I'm like, physics, the whole magnets, bro. The magnets, bro.
Yeah, dumbass.
So the magnets use electromagnetism to attract
them.
Metals.
Yes.
But somehow they don't affect the metal of the car that they're in. Yet they're the strongest electromagnetic attractors that from a street over, they can attract a different car and drag it through three buildings into the vehicle. But somehow it does not affect the metal of the vehicle that it's in.
Yeah.
Or any of the other metal around.
It's pretty simple.
Just the vehicle from the street over.
It works exactly how they need it to work.
And then, when they're driving, I'm so pissed about these magnets, man. Listen. Because they only ever do exactly what they need them to do. Okay, the Fast and Furious movies are very good at just disregarding the laws of physics, right? And the Ludacris' character says that a lot. It's like, oh, dude, with the laws of – we just disregarding the laws of physics. They're self-aware with that. But then they also just disregard their own rules that they set up. And they throw them out the window with these fucking magnets, man. With these magnets. Are these magnets super strong or are they not? I don't know, man.
Don't think about it too much, dude.
I know, and that was the problem is like, I was just sitting there like, dude. And especially when they go to space, I'm like, dude, they're in diving suits, man. This would not. Fuck.
You're thinking about this.
I think it was great.
I mean, yeah, it was fun.
I think it was really good.
It was a fun romp. I enjoyed it a lot. Man, dude, I just, at every turn, I was like, dude, what
at every turn?
The fuck? Fuck you. I was like, what the hell is going on here?
Every quarter mile?
Yeah. Like, so there's that. And that was Fast 9. So there you go.
Quarter mile at a time.
We might actually rank all the Fast and Furious movies.
I want to.
We will.
I want to rewatch them.
Yeah, so that might happen. And then, of course, Black Widow. So I'm going to get into full spoiler mode for Black Widow to finish off the show for the next 5 to 10 minutes.
If you haven't seen it, get out. Blah, blah,
blah. Goodbye.
Last warning. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Black Widow.
Yelena.
Okay, Yelena.
Belova.
I'm glad everyone else is finally on the Florence Pugh fan club.
Yeah, Isaiah agrees.
The Florence Pugh fan club is now 4-man strong now, which is great to hear.
I think everybody's.
So there's a couple of things here that I want to note. Let's start with a broad brush here. I think Black Widow is a better movie if you release it after Civil War, before Infinity War. Personal blanket statement, in my opinion, disregarding the end credit scene. I think Black Widow is a better movie because you don't know that she's going to die. You don't know all of that stuff. And so I think it would be a better movie.
I think it was better because I knew she was dead.
And I don't think so.
I think so.
I think it becomes better.
Appreciate her more.
Yeah, it made me appreciate, like, oh, she was really doing stuff. Like, damn.
But I think if you release it at the time, just after Civil War, before Infinity War comes out.
I think Endgame becomes a better movie if you release this before.
Yeah, well, yeah, but and then I
don't think this becomes a better movie. I think this becomes a worse movie. I think it's, depending on which one comes last, becomes a better movie. I think this is better because it comes after.
I don't know. Other than that, I don't have many problems with this movie, if any at all.
I don't think I do either.
I think it was super fucking enjoyable. Mm-hmm. I think the comedy was hitting every single joke smack.
David Harbour played his character to the T.
Yeah.
Florence Pugh did.
Oh my Scar God, Joe did bro.
Good as Black Widow.
I don't want to talk about Florence Pugh yet because I'm going to go for 10 minutes. But Florence Pugh killed it.
Yeah.
She did that one.
I think the writing's good. You get some nice tidbits about the origin of Black Widow and Scarlett Johansson, Natasha Romanoff. You get some interesting tidbits about her and Barton's past in Budapest with the, hey, what guns make these? She's like, oh, it's arrows, right? Because insinuating that she was in that safe house and was getting hunted by Barton.
Yeah.
With her having to kill that guy and her and his daughter as part of her defection to S.H.I.E.L.D. And Barton being like, okay, is everything good to go? So you're finally learning what's happening in Budapest. Yeah. That's nice. And then just getting some context as to kind of some of the things that were happening with the other group in the in-between time of Civil War and Infinity War. Because you see what's going on with everyone else, but you never really get to see what's going on with Cap and the gang in that time. They dip out in Civil War, and you don't see them again until Infinity War.
Yeah.
And so getting some context of Natasha Romanoff being like, oh, you got a bug on you, bro? Yeah, a beetle? Yeah, bro. A beetle?
Who let in the bug, bro? Yeah.
And so you get some...
You open the door.
You open the door. So you get some interesting... Dude, this bug... And so you get some context of that in-between time where it's like, oh, shit, where you realize that, like, oh, they kind of stayed in prison and things like that, and then she got the jet and ended up going and picking them all up.
Yeah, she was the one that saved them.
Yeah, and so that's nice.
I think it was good. A really, really good movie.
Yeah.
There's an argument for where it fits in the movies. It could be, I think it's top five. Or not top five, top 10.
I think it's top 10. I think it ranks in the top third to top quarter of Marvel movies. And I think it's great. I thought it was really enjoyable. I'm pretty sure Adriana puts it in her top five. I would argue maybe it comes close or might be in there. I don't know. Definitely top 10. Like six, definitely seven. Top 10.
Yeah, it's top five.
It was great.
Oh, dude, David Harbour is so good.
Yeah, David
Harbour. His character's amazing.
Dude,
somehow they made his asshole-ass character have an emotional moment with the American Pie scene.
Yeah.
Which was nice. Him singing.
The combat in that movie is brutal.
The fighting scenes were great. Mm. I can't get over just every single joke landed, and especially every single one that Florence Pugh said. I was just this is fucking hilarious.
When they're in the plane, right after picking him up.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so good. Good.
So good. Her jumping and doing the pose and then being like, oh.
Yeah,
that was gross. And then standing in the middle of the shop and being like, "Why do you always do the thing with your hair?" And she's like,
"It's just so good,
so good."
I'll watch it again.
Yeah, I will as well. What was some of the other the beats that I wanted to talk about that I can't remember now. I thought everything was enjoyable. The villain was good. Getting some context on him. City in the Sky. The end credits scene.
Dark Avengers.
I don't know, but just setting up for Hawkeye. Real nice.
Yeah, I don't like the idea that Yelena's gonna be fighting Barton.
You know that it's quickly gonna be understood that she realizes that it was a different thing, and then they're gonna team up against somebody else, bro. Come on, man.
Come on,
it's happening.
Yeah, but like, I don't know.
I'm just glad we're getting more Yelena.
Yes.
That's what I'm mainly glad about. Twitter seems to be more pissed about the Black Widow movie because of Taskmaster, which I don't give a shit about Taskmaster really, so that didn't really do anything for me. But no. The gender swap of Taskmaster and the fact that it was kind of relegated to a little side role and didn't really have a big role was causing people to kind of be not
I understand happy. The it being a smaller role thing. Like, it, I feel like Taskmaster should have been a bigger part of it and not just the lackey. Of this whole thing, and there's
maybe they'll blow her character out a little more in the future.
Because I don't know, or maybe you introduce a second Taskmaster.
Yeah, they definitely left room for it.
They've done it with the Mandarin.
Yeah,
In Iron Man 3.
Yeah,
everybody was like, "What the hell? This is not the Mandarin we signed up for."
Yeah,
and then you're getting it in Shang-Chi.
Yeah, so
maybe they'll do something like that.
I don't know, but it definitely did some interesting stuff there. Got to set up. I honestly, in the end credit scene when she whistles, I was not convinced that we weren't going to hear a whistle.
I thought I was going to hear a whistle back and that she was going to be alive and I was going to be pissed.
Me too.
I was going to really be like, whoa.
Yeah, it was going to be like a double, or I was going to be like, bruh, but also bruh. Yeah. Like, oh, what's happening here? So that was going to be fun, but that didn't happen. So that was glad. So, I think all in all, really good film, and it can't be overstated how much Florence Pugh stole the show.
And I think that is the general consensus.
Every single scene that she's in, she kills it. You just want to watch whatever she's doing. She steals the show. Every scene that she's in.
No flat moments for her. Because I do feel like Natasha has flat moments. You don't really get that for Florence.
Her character, fleshed out and great. Her comedy, killer. Her action scenes, awesome. Just everything about Florence Pugh's character was like, I think she had the best scene in the movie. And one of the most emotional scenes I've seen just in a Marvel movie, which was her explanation to her family of like, it was fake to y'all.
It was real.
But nobody fucking told me. Mm-hmm. And so it was real to me.
Yeah.
And that scene like broke me. And you don't see a lot. You're starting to see it a little more in the more modern movies, Marvel movies, with like these emotional moments, like with or just Marvel properties, with like Wanda breaking down, the Vision thing. Like, you're starting to see like these really hard hitting emotional moments. Like, they're getting cranked up to 10, and I think this is the highest hitting one thus far. It is interesting to note though that they had to edit that end credit scene, I think, because originally that was supposed to be the first showing of Valentino, right? Valentina, because that was supposed to be before Falcon and the Winter Soldier.
Yeah.
So you have to imagine that scene probably had more in it where she was like, oh, I'm this person and this person and this person. And they probably cut it
I don't know.
Because they introduced. Because there's like, they kind of talked to her. It was like, oh, hi, Valentina. Oh, blah, blah, blah. And then they give you the thing. And I feel like there had to be like, she was more fleshed out. And then they just edited it post.
Maybe. I don't.
I think COVID has caused them to re-edit a lot of stuff, but we'll have to see.
Maybe.
I don't know. But I fucking love Black Widow.
I did too. I thought it was really good.
And that's enjoyable. It for this episode of the Synced Up Filmcast.
We still got a post show.
Thank you for watching or listening to this episode. If you support us on Patreon at the $5 tier, you get access to the post show that we are about to do. So for you guys that do that, we will see you guys in a few minutes. And for everyone else, we'll see you guys next week.
Goodbye.
Bye.